Peter, you wanted me to say this for us. I'm going to say it to open the show because it's a little bit complicated, okay? And I'm going to try to just spell it out in words. The show is about reasonable expectations with regard to accessibility for all people, especially the disabled, into a learning facility. So the show is about reasonable expectations.
Yep, most definitely. I don't know why, for some weird reason, my brain just won't let me wrap around saying that title. But we're here for episode 29 is this episode right now, so that's awesome to know. But I guess, like, when we start thinking about, like, what is, you know, what is reasonable in education or what's reasonable, for, you know, either receiving assistance or talking to, persons with disabilities and getting, like, acceptable accommodations and things like that, you know, the thought is, what would we consider reasonable? What would we consider not reasonable? You know, there's tons of different definitions depending on your chosen professions or chosen thoughts. But I guess to start this off, Sonia, what would be some thoughts that you had?
Well, my thoughts, we discussed it a little bit, and I can get a little bit of a chuckle on this, but I think that there were some expectations that we just, you know, took for granted with regard to a lot of things, especially when it came to expectations in, for instance, getting a wheelchair into a building. So our country and our state had become pretty conscious of people that were disabled. So there was always a ramp into a building. And for someone that might have a wheelchair or someone that might just have trouble walking, you can at least expect a handrail. That would be my reasonable expectation when entering a building. Thank God I'm not in a wheelchair, but I do appreciate a handrail. Because, you know, when you diagnose with a disorder like multiple sclerosis, there are times where you're feeling just a little bit off balance, you know, or you do it just for a safety reason. I'm not going to go down, you know, a steep flight of stairs or even a steep ramp if I'm holding on. So I feel it's reasonable for me to expect a handrailing, you know. I don't expect someone to come and carry me into the building. That's not a reasonable expectation in most cases, but I think that it's reasonable to expect a handrail. You know, we have a lot of disabled veterans coming back. Where I live, there are a lot of veterans, you know, that sort of live in the area and the surrounding area. And I think that it's reasonable for them to expect a handrail. Many of them are in wheelchairs. Some of them just have difficulty walking. I know one gentleman happens to be an artist, very good artist, too. But he just has trouble walking. But, you know, he does walk, but there's difficulty. And he experiences pain from injuries that he sustained when he was a combat vet, a paratrooper, you know? So, you know, you got to think, you know, hitting the ground from the sky, sometimes things happen. So I think it's reasonable for him to expect that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, if, you know, when we're thinking like, public places, public access, things like that, and, you know, we think of ourselves going in there, you know, obviously, like for myself, having blindness and visual impairment, my reasonable thought would be going into, a place of like, you know, business or education or whatever it might be, and being able to, either, for instance, receive something, either in like larger print if I need it, or being able to, be able to talk to someone and get something read to me, you know, things like that. You know, I don't need someone to, like, for instance, like you said, you know, fill out paperwork for me or anything like that. You know, I just need someone to read it to me so I can, you know, fill out the designated areas, things like that. whether it be financial or important business forms, or whether it be education, homework, or, you know, whatever mm-hmm. types of materials you might have. It's one of those things where we start looking at public locations, and we start looking at, like, educational institutions and things like that, and there's this big debate about, you know, like, what's considered reasonable accommodation, and, you know, the reasonable accommodation gets intertwined with our expectations, our reasonable expectations of what we believe a public service or vendor or educational institution should provide. Because I think, like you said, is that there actually are people out there who take those advantages, who would want somebody to, you know, it's a little bit of an over-exaggeration, but using this as a metaphor, is to have them basically be carried up the stairs or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
That would be what a lot of people would be considered as an unreasonable accommodation or unreasonable expectation. Versus if, like, they were able to provide something, you know, like a ramp or a railing or whatever it is, that would be not only in a reasonable accommodation, but also be a reasonable expectation. Because, I mean,
right.
not even for those who have disabilities, even just for those who are going there, it'd be even more convenient for them to have a railing or, you know, even a ramp. I mean, you know, sometimes
right.
just the way people's walking styles are, maybe it might be a balance thing, you know, you never know.
Right.
It's important, but it is kind of sad though that right now we are kind of facing this whole, thing with the ADA and accessible accommodations and things like that, where, we're trying to figure out, like, how much are companies and how much are educators and educational institutions paying attention to, getting and receiving accommodations so their students or their, customers can perform things in a reasonable amount of way. And when they don't provide these things, you know, what we would consider there is reasonable expectation, then we voice ourselves and think that this would be a reasonable accommodation, and they don't
mm-hmm.
provide those simple necessities. I mean, we as a people with disabilities lose out, and then them as the institutions mm-hmm. who are not providing these things are losing out because they're not having more of an audience and more people coming into their institution. I mean,
right.
I've seen fantastic institutions that are not accessible. That would be fantastic to be accessible.
Mm-hmm.
One of the, you know, like, one of the things I can say using an example, and we're not sponsored anyway, guys, so this is just, you know, a thing putting out there for a company that I support myself, is saying, for instance, for Apple. Apple is accessible because a lot of their places, particularly if you're here in the state of Minnesota, at the Mall of America, their floor is at the same floor as the rest of the mall. So there's no ramp, there's no steps, there's nothing to go there. However, if you've ever been to an Apple store, their front windows or a lot of their place is a lot of glass, and it's a lot of see-through glass, and what I've always considered and always thought to be a reasonable expectation for the company is to have something a little bit identifying as to where the door ends and where the door begins.
Yeah.
As many of people who even don't have my visual impairment have found out, it's difficult to figure that out.
Mm-hmm.
And when that happens, and, like, let's say somebody runs into the door or, you know, whatever it might be, I mean, they have a bad experience. So, I mean, you know, why don't you just put, like, a little sign or, you know, something on there to kind
mm-hmm.
of designate that there's a door there? Of course, this is, like, a real, you know, way out there kind of example, because, you know,
mm-hmm.
I don't have, like, a wheelchair, so I don't use, like, a ramp or need it accessibility for a ramp, but it's kind of that same exact idea where
yeah.
if we don't actively evolve and actively innovate, we can lose our customers, we can lose our students, and it causes a whole bunch of problems, you know?
Yeah. It's problems that you definitely don't need. I think it's
mm-hmm.
interesting that we actually have to have this conversation. I thought this problem was solved, this kind of thing, like, decades ago. You know, now we're having this conversation about accessibility.
Yeah. It's something that we've always, you know, we've always hoped would be solved, or at least would be solved to a point where we wouldn't have to have these conversations. But unfortunately, and I really hate saying this, but this is going to be an ongoing battle no matter what. And I hate to say battle, but it really is at times, because you really, you get to such a point where you need to voice what you need. And when companies or educators or educational institutions don't listen to what people would consider reasonable accommodations and expectations going into their services, when they don't innovate and look into providing those things, then we have to battle. We have to do like lawsuits, or we have to bring some sort of legal based attention to them, or we have to write something, you know, in a suggestion box, whatever it is. But I feel that this battle is something that it's on both sides, because like you said, is that we have to, as a community, have to have reasonable expectations going into, you know, whatever it is that we're going into, but also it's on the business side where they need to have reasonable accommodations to go, you know, for their systems. Because I have always considered this, that if you are a public like company or business, you want to like you're on a street corner, let's say, right? Or well, not maybe not a street corner, but you have a business in the middle of like a busy place. If you're trying to pull in like tons of traffic, you should have in the back of your brain, I might get a blind person. I might get a person who can't walk. I might get a person who can't hear. You know, having those initiatives and having those backup plans is very important.
Yeah, I know people that have like attitudes about a lot of things, and there's some people who just are completely unaware, and so they don't consider, you know, that there might be someone that has lesser capabilities than they do, you know, in terms of mobility. For instance, for me, in the summertime, I don't like the heat. I don't like it when it's humid and hot. So if I go into a job or a place or a store and there's no air conditioning, I really do suffer with, you know, MS is not friendly. MS and humidity and heat are not compatible, you know, and you know, when you're very sensitive to changes in temperature like that, you know, it can literally be disabling. And it's kind of like sort of thing that happened to my mother, you know, because we didn't have air conditioning when I was growing up, and she had MS as well. And I sometimes think maybe that had contributed to her demise back then. But I can't work or live in a place that doesn't have air conditioning in the summertime. You know, it's like I really suffer. Mm-hmm. And my eyes get blurry. I can't see well. You know, it's terrible. You know? Mm-hmm. So is it reasonable expectation for me? Is it reasonable for me to expect every store that I walk into to have, you know, air conditioning, or is it unreasonable?
Well, you know, and that's a very good question, because on one side of it, you know, I can definitely see, you know, what you're hoping for. I mean, obviously you're thinking if they're a public business, they're fully established, you know, they should have comfort in mind, right? You know, comfort and accessibility in mind. That should be something on their priority list. Cause, I mean, you know, you want more people to come and you want them to have a good experience. At the same time, you know, you have these big corporations that are like, well, you know, here's my store. You have a choice of coming into it or not coming into it. And then they don't make those advancements. And in my opinion, like in that particular sense, I would say that if you're a well-established place, or, you know, you're really public or whatever it might be, I would reasonably say, yeah, I think that you should have air conditioning. If you're going to be like, you know, like a teeny tiny shop, whatever, you know, that's like, you know, someone really, really small business, like either just starting or just a really, you know, one-time store type person, I would say reasonable expectations. You may or may not, you know, get air conditioning, so to speak. But it's just, I think like exactly like that is just, striving to inform as much as possible. Even, and I hate to say this, even if it slightly embarrasses, because I do that too, where I have to inform people of, like, you know, I either don't see something or I can't do something.
Right.
And it's slightly embarrassing at times, but you know, it's something that I have to unfortunately chew down and take care of, because I'm like, well, you know, I have an expectation. If it can't be met, can I at least find some middle ground, you know, for anything, you know?
Well, I know. I think that's reasonable. It's funny. I have a relative who has two relatives have developed some visual impairment, and one of them, actually, I went to a movie with her recently, and it was interesting seeing it. She really wanted to see it. I don't know what she sees, but she'll let me know what she can't see. You know, it's kind of like, what she can't see, I can see. What I can't see, she can see. I don't know if that's exactly, but it seemed that way a little bit, but what she can't see, I can see. You know, but she's, does like to go to a movie. I think it's reasonable for her to expect a seat that is at a proper distance for her visual acuity. I think that, it's funny, I find that people, visual impairment will have you see things that other people will never see. That I know, I can attest to that. You know, I never expected that. You know, that's not something I expected out of my color blindness in one eye. But for you, Peter, you're just so amazing, because I don't know whether it's a sixth sense that you have that makes you so skilled at doing things with technology, visual things, you know, but no one would expect that of you. But, you know, getting back to your situation, I think there's a reasonable expectation that you can have that when you go into an establishment that they actually turn the lights on, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think that's reasonable expectation, you know? But some people, I know someone who doesn't turn the lights on. She walks around at night in the dark. She's very comfortable with it. You know, I mean, thank goodness, you know, I don't live with her or anything, because I find it a little creepy. But, you know, because
it becomes habit.
In a way. Yeah, that's true. You know, just as long as you don't booby trap the place, you know.
You know, and actually, there's actually a good point here, is that when you were talking about, like, the movie theater thing, like, this is a great example of this, is that when there was, like, movies out there a while ago, you know, we used to just have movies. You know, they'd be movies, you know, we could still hear audio, you know, and still experience the movie. But for those with, like, blindness and visual impairment, we could only experience scenes where people were, like, actively conversing, or there was actual music or things going on. And it got to a point where, you know, we thought that a reasonable thought and expectation that we thought that we could have for the movie theaters is having audio description. And audio description was highly frowned upon for the longest time, because they're like, well, we need to get people to record it, or, you know, we need to get headphones and things like that. Nowadays, you know, we go in there, and because audio description is now available in multiple different places, we go into movie theaters and we hope that, you know, there's an audio description device, or for that matter, there's also audio amplifying devices as well for those with hard of hearing. And we go into there thinking about that being a reasonable expectation, and that being also a reasonable accommodation that, to be fair, has gotten easier over the years because of technology and the ability to either record or synthesize audio description, things like that. But back then, we had to designate, you know, why this was such a reasonable thing. And the whole idea was, is because, you know, then we didn't have somebody who was next to us, you know, telling us every 5 seconds, you know, what was going on the television or on the movie, you know, because they'd be like, people around them be like, you know, hey, you know, you gotta be quiet or something like that or whatever, you know.
If you can't see the whole thing, it's like, if I was sitting next to you in the movie and we're watching, like, some kind of thriller, I mean, I think that, you know, I might say, he stabbed her. You know? Because you didn't see it. You know?
Yeah.
You hear the music going crazy, how they make the music for that. You know? Someone's going to tell you. He's sneaking up on her with a gun. You know? Or whatever. You know what I mean? And you have to... I'm only kind of laughing because I have these friends who are musicians and they actually write the music for certain kinds of movies, you know, the kind of, you know, when you hear the music change a little bit, you know something's up, right? Well, they write that, like that music that tells you subliminally something's up, you know? So, but I imagine that has some meaning for you in the movie theater. You know, because it has meaning for people that can see. You know, your heart starts to beat a little harder, you know. And then so if you're not really seeing what's going on, it would be reasonable for, you know, the person that's visually impaired to turn to you and say, as they hear that da da da, you know, that somebody got a shocker. So you have to say, she walked in the room and there was a dead body, you know. So then you know what the music was for. So the audio descriptions that you're talking about they're kind of like some things that people produce specifically for specific movies for people that are visually impaired, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So like, it's definitely like the same idea as if we, you know, if you had somebody, like, so to speak, over your shoulder telling you what was going on, but instead of, you know, in that physical sense, you know, where people might be able to overhear you, you'd have a headset instead.
Mm-hmm.
But the great point here, though, is that you're making that is completely valid is that in certain situations where, you know, where movie theaters are, where there isn't audio description, you know, they have to take that into effect that this is reasonable. You know, if you are looking to have a customer be fully satisfied with their experience, then, you know, whoever's with them should be able to help satisfy their experience because, you know, you're unable to. But yeah, what they are is just for anybody who's curious out there, audio described movies are typically pre-recorded movies. They typically have a contract with certain recording companies after they've created the movie. And they will record them, and then they'll make the soundtracks available to the movie theaters when the movies come to their places. And you will have a headset and a receiver, and you turn on the receiver, and you have your headset on, and you will be able to hear the movie through your headset as well as the audio description at the same time. Or if you go to a website, it's called blindmicemall.com.
Blindmicemall.com.
The website has like different pieces of technology and things for blindness and visual impairment, but the great thing about this site is that they are authorized, if you are blind or visually impaired, you can go on the site, create a free profile, and they have a whole library of audio described movies and TV shows you can download as MP3s on your devices so you can enjoy them at home after they become available on the DVD market.
How cool is that? That's very, very good. I love that. I'm going to tell I have two people I'm going to tell about that. Blind My Small.
Yep.
You know, they're both, one of them is very frustrated not being able to do certain things.
Mm-hmm. And you guys, when you go to the website too, you're looking for the movie vault. That's the links that you want to click on there. Once you get to the movie vault, you can choose anything from really older type movies that they may have begun to record currently, or you might decide to do something rather current, you know, in like 2017, 18. And getting back to my thought though is just that, like you said, I mean, if for instance, I go to the movie theater and I'm expecting, you know, a reasonable expectation of having audio description and, you know, for some weird reason, you know, whether they don't have it or the device is broken or whatever it is, then if, like, for instance, someone says, you know, like a person sitting near us who is sitting in the movie theater comes up to a person and says, you know, they're talking in the movie theater, it's like, well, that's because you have to. You know, it's not like, oh, my God, you know, I'm talking to the top of my lungs and this is like you hear only me type thing. But, you know, the idea is like if you're whispering to someone else and explaining what's going on, you know, it has to be understood that that's just the way it is, you know.
So blind mice fault, I'd say get the audio device. I think that's the best way to handle that. I mean, for, you know, listen, when certain things go on, like emergency situations that we have, like, you know, we've had some crazy weather, and you see, like, a mayor of a city will stand up in front of the camera and be talking about or whoever, officials, talking about what you got to do or talking about whatever. And there's always somebody mm-hmm. there next to them that's helping the hearing, they don't like the word hearing impaired, they like you to call them deaf. So deaf people, and they have someone there that's actually doing American or French or whatever sign language, and letting them know what's going on because it's important. I think it's reasonable for the visually impaired or blind people to get somebody that will actually do an audio for them to be able to see what they can't see, just like the people that are, you know, hearing disabled, deaf people. I don't know what the exact term is. My friend who's deaf says, just say deaf, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And she said she talks about it a bit. We should have her on the show. But I think the problem is that because she is unable to hear as well as we do, I don't know exactly how we'll do it. We have to figure out a technical way to do it. But she does work with an organization. But getting back to the point, they can reasonably expect there to be someone doing sign language in those emergency situations when they can't hear what's being said on the TV. They reasonably can expect, you know, SAP, which is, I don't know if that's, wait, is that the language thing or is that the other language thing? But they can reasonably expect subtitles. I have a friend who lives across the street from me. It doesn't hear well at all, and, you know, he sometimes goes deaf, something about earwax. I'm not sure what the reason is. But when it gets bad, you can't hear a thing, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And he has his TV set, apparently. I've never been to his apartment, maybe once or something. It turns it up really loud and disturbs his neighbors. Or he's changed back now that he's figured out how to put on the subtitle. He can watch the subcaptions, you know?
Yeah.
But he can reasonably expect to have that on his TV set. You know, at this point, I hope that that's not taken away. I hope that they continue that and don't decide to do something foolish, like not provide it. So I'm going to keep the faith that he'll always be able to have that option.
Yeah. The thing with that is I'm guessing the way that our technology is that using mobile devices for instance, we have like Netflix, we have Hulu, we have all these great different platforms for streaming content. And they are continuously providing the services of being able to have like closed captioning, audio description, things like that. I see the future of like audio description, captions, accessible media and things. Because it's becoming so much easier to create digitized content. I don't think it'll ever go away. Actually, the interesting thing is that for like closed captions and things like that, they're creating, you know, obviously they have different languages by now, you know, they're going into numerous more different languages of closed captioning, but the, you know, there's typical ones you would see, but yeah, if you were to go on to a streaming service, you know, you would think that's a reasonable expectation, or put in the DVD or whatever your preference in media is, you would think the reasonable expectation for, you know, your particular circumstances would be accommodated in that instance. I think that with the, like I said, with the advancements of technology, it's only made it easier for us to accommodate, you know, different disabilities and different ways of life. However, because it's easier to accommodate, because we're creating more digitalized content, the expectation, I think, becomes greater, because, you know, there's more demand for expansion. And I think that as much as I would love to see, you know, as many networks with audio description and closed captioning and all these great different services. Not everybody can support this. So it becomes a question on like the business owner side, you know, well, this is what I can provide, you know, you can decide to view it or not. And it's mm-hmm. unfortunate, you know, everybody's not perfect. You know, it happens that, not everybody has the money to get those services or create the content for those services. But I think that in those cases, as long as they continue to strive towards it or continue to say that they're going for it is what counts. The important thing on that aspect, though, is because of the current stuff with the ADA, what is being considered the waiting period for the accommodations and expectations period of the ADA right now. Don't say that you're making progress and then like drag it out for like 2 or 3 years or something like that. In my opinion, if you're going to do something, you're going to be a business or something, and you are mm-hmm. legitimately going to go for this, say, you know, I have to, you know, I'm working to do this or that, you know, so then you don't incur these issues where people come to you and then they wait for this to happen and all of a sudden you got how many hundred people breathing down your neck. If you're not planning on, you know, changing things up, it's going to hurt you, but I would rather you be honest. You know, I'm not one, you know, the community that we have is persons with multiple different disabilities and ways of life. Mm-hmm. We're strong and we don't like bullshit, you know? We're not there to, you know, listen to, you know, promises and fabrications and all this stuff. We want to know, are you going to help us or are you not going to help us? Because we are moving in our lives, you know, and we need to keep rolling and, you know.
And I think based on the disability and the types of disabilities that you have and other people have in your particular community, there really isn't a lot of time to be wasting. You know what I'm saying? It's not like you have time to sit around and, mm-hmm. you know, nitpick and find, you know, I mean, some things are just so obvious. They're just obvious. You know, it's not something that you have to consider anything but obvious, frankly. I think it's obvious that I feel it's a reasonable expectation to get some kind of an audio, device or access to the audio of something that you can't actually see. There's some beautiful movies that don't have a lot of dialogue. They just have a lot of music. I mean, it happens. But it doesn't mean that it's wrong. I mean, you know, what did people do before there was sound? They just didn't hear the movie or see the movie. I think that it's reasonable to expect that. I think that people that are unable to hear can reasonably expect that if there's a snowstorm, and this year, at least in the Northeast, there are plenty of snowstorms, and every time the mayor spoke, you know, there was someone standing there that was doing sign language to make sure that everybody was safe. I think that the changes that they've made to the ADA, definitely, if not completely, I think they border on discrimination against the disabled, you know?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And that's for like kind of a back thought too, is like, you know, before we had like audio description, you know, for those who have blindness, visual impairment, that's why you see a lot of people who are blind or visually impaired know about a lot of musicals or a lot about music because, or maybe theater, for instance, because those are continuous platforms of dialogue or music or things like that that are completely auditory. For instance, those with, like, hearing loss or, you know, hard of hearing, different types of audios or, you know, video or whatever it is, you might see them being, you know, very intelligent artists that might know a lot about art or maybe animation, video creation, things like that. It's an interesting thought. But yeah, definitely like today's world with the changes in the ADA, it is borderline discrimination. Because the ultimate idea is that instead of having clear guidelines and clear understanding of what is considered a violation or not, our borders, so to speak, of accessibility or non-accessibility or reasonable expectations or non-reasonable is so blurred right now that ultimately the customer or even the business person gets so confused that we just get lost. And that's why, as much as I hate to say it, the government needs to man up and get somebody responsible for regulating ADA compliance and understanding, because if we don't have someone or a standard that designates what is good and what is bad for ADA accessibility, we're just going to sit here continuously having guidelines for everything that are, you know, well, we can choose to be helpful and be and go with them, or we can choose to not be helpful and go with them.
I think that part of what's happened, from what I understand, is that there's no incentive for being compliant to ADA, you know, standards, at least the ADA standards that used to exist. So there's no incentive to do that, or they are taking away the incentive for businesses to do that. Because I believe me, if I could make my place of business completely handicapped accessible, I would. It would probably be grandfathered, but, you know, let's put it this way. It's not unusual for people that are disabled to say that they don't want to take the chance to struggle up 14 steps to come into my loft to shop or look at art. So I tend to take my act somewhere else. So I tend to do things in other spaces that have the wall space. It's not my particular workspace, but to exhibit in other people's spaces, especially those that have spaces that are on a ground floor or have an elevator, you know, because then handicapped people can come in. You know, so if I owned the building and there was an incentive for me to make this building handicap accessible, I would. But I don't know if there's much incentive when there's two people live here, they're both artists, they have two separate places, and we're not complaining that much about it. We're just struggling and doing the best we can, you know, getting up the stairs, down the stairs. Ugh, that's gruesome, going down the stairs. But I think, and we did the show about my dog with PTSD who fell down the stairs and developed PTSD, you know? So in any case, you know, getting off the dog and talking about people, I just think it's appropriate to help people that have less, you know, ability or, you know, physically or whatever than an individual might have. I think it's just the right thing to do. But I liked it when most of it was etched in law. You know, but as we know, nothing stays the same. Everything changes. Nothing is forever, you know?
Yeah. Well, and you know, and the thing is, too, it's like they talk about these drive-by lawsuits and things like that. And I'm not going to discredit and say that, you know, those don't happen. Like I said, is that we ourselves have to understand what is reasonable expectation and what is reasonable accommodation, at least in our personal way of doing things and expecting a business to do things. So that I will definitely say is, you know, there are drive-by lawsuits where people can't just go up and say that something isn't accessible without considering that maybe their accommodation that they need isn't considered, you know, reasonable. But the problem today is that we are looking at, you know, having our businesses and having our organizations bound by, instead of having a set rule book, so to speak, or well, maybe not a rule book, but maybe just like, you know, boundaries at least, because we're having them go by guidelines. Like you said, there isn't incentives to, you know, to having, you know, your places accessible or things like that. I do know, I don't know if they'd be necessarily be incentives or not, but there are like accommodation taxes and things like that for, you know, different types of like structures and things, but I don't know the specifics of that, but, ultimately, because the government has made it so lax now and so the line's mm-hmm. so blurred, our businesses are struggling. Our businesses are struggling, and then the people are struggling because they, you know, they want to go into those businesses. You know, they want to patronize and talk to people, or you know, one of the major stories that I can put to the table here is I'm a huge technology guy. I love technology. I use it every day, mm-hmm. and my reasonable expectation is that when I go into, like, let's say, you know, your typical computer store, I'm thinking of three different things. I'm thinking, A, someone can talk to me and give me reasonable information. Whether they can or can't is dependent upon their skills or talking to me. And then my others are, you know, that if I am talking to someone, like, let's say, about a piece of technology or my technology, for instance, that they're either able to verbalize what they're doing, or that I'm able to have verbalized via the technology of what's going on.
Uh-huh.
And then the third thing is like, if I receive any paperwork, possibly having the option to have a digital version of like either the receipt or paperwork or whatever it is. For the most part, these have all been met. You know, the paper, is, you know, having paper copies and things is, you know, it, at times it's reasonable, and at other times I see it, you know, yes, it could be a little bit stressful, but, like if I'm going and I'm buying a piece of technology and the whole place is about technology, mm-hmm. I would like to think that you have the ability to give me a digital receipt or something that, you know, I have a digital record of, or that I can read myself.
Right.
And the thing is too, is today it makes it better too. It's less paper that you have to waste. I mean, you know, mm-hmm. I mean,
I hear you with that because, you know, even as a sighted person, I always ask if I can have my receipt emailed, you know, mm-hmm. and companies are slowly getting into that because I can't stand those little receipts though. It's driving me nuts. Finally, I got an assistant that came up with a solution to it, you know, but mm-hmm. I still think it's unnecessary paper, you know, email my receipt.
Yeah.
That's what I want.
Yeah.
They want paper.
Well, and I love it too, because like they would have these, you know, I'd have very excellent type customer service with different people, and they would be like, you know, do you want a paper receipt or do you want a digital receipt? And I always ask them, can I get both? Well, you know, in some cases, yes, I've gotten both. I've gotten a physical mm-hmm. and a digital. In other cases, no. But
mm-hmm.
Am I going to, you know, straight out say, oh well, you have to provide me both? No, but as long as I can access the information in some shape or form or converse with someone to get that information, mm-hmm. that's what would be considered a, you know, reasonable expectation.
Yeah.
Now, if I told them, like, they had to, like, for instance, I don't know, make, you know, some outrageous claim, like, I need the paper to be blue as well as I need to only have it in paper form, They wouldn't consider that to be a reasonable expectation or accommodation, because it'd just be like, well, we're not going to make it blue for everybody.
I get it. I look at some people, the way they design things, and they do these gradients of green. And what happens is, with my eyesight, unless I close one eye, I can't see anything. I don't know what the hell that says. You know, mm-hmm. because it makes, you know, I don't know why that happens, but it does.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm like, I can't make it like a different color, black and white, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah.
What's wrong with that?
Well, and that's the thing. And that's why, like, I always ask for, like, a digital receipt or the great thing that I would recommend to anyone too, who's having like this dilemma, who might be going to a lot of places that may not have like digital receipts quite yet. I would suggest if you have a phone, You know, depending on how good the camera is, maybe take a picture of it, or maybe your camera or computer, whatever it is. You know, I'm not sure what it is, but the idea is that you want is if you're looking for a digitized record, and the establishment can't provide that or won't provide that for you, then, you know, that's a solution around it. But it's interesting because, like, the more we get technologically advanced, the more expectation for reasonable expectations, reasonable accommodations it becomes, but also the more pressure it is on businesses, or at least the pressure that should be there, for them to innovate and continue to increase in positive ways. But because our ADA is still somewhat limited, they, you know, businesses aren't required to make accommodations. Like for websites, they don't have to make their websites accessible unless someone tells them and there's a lawsuit. If there's no lawsuit and no one tells them, they can leave them inaccessible and just say, hey, you know what, here's our site. You can either come in or walk away. And it's unfortunate, but that's just how it is.
I know. It's so frustrating, you know, and it's scary to me. Very scary to me, you know? So,
yeah.
I mean, I don't want to say why it's scary to me because I don't want to keep you scared, but it is. I find it like very unsettling. Some of the things. You know?
Yeah. Well, because I mean, it's the question of like, you know, is my right now for a lot of people with many different types of disabilities, many different types of ways that they do things or that they go to, for instance, a simple thing as a grocery store or maybe as complex as going to somewhere and buying a new piece of technology. They're wondering, you know, is my voice being heard? Is my opinion worth it? You know, all these different things. When they go into a place of business or place of education, you know, I mean, are they hearing me? And the concern is that, you know, are we going down a path where those with disabilities have less and less of a voice, or is it that they still have a voice, but it needs to be so gosh darn specific that, you know, the average person is not going to be able to talk, so to speak, you know?
You got to be like a road scholar. You know, and say, you know, something just to get in the door pathway. But I think that what you're saying is valid. Cause like when I told you, I think it was our last show or the show before that, there were disabled people in wheelchairs and canes, you know, in our government Congress, making a ruckus in the back. And they just like acted like it didn't even happen. It was this strange almost. I don't like using this word because I think people use it the wrong way, but the word surreal, because what you could see, you couldn't hear anything. You just saw the congressman and the senator turn around and they're looking up at the balcony and you couldn't see who was on the balcony, but the bewildered look on the senator's faces, you know, and I think then there was some news footage that they showed later. We actually saw that, you know, during this whole, when this first whole big scandal in the White House happened, this latest one, it was a sex scandal. So naturally, you know, everybody's going to be paying attention to that, and which is as they will should. But it just seems a little more interesting, I imagine. And I don't know. I don't want to point fingers. All I know is I thought that it was just disgraceful. You know, then they go and they pass the bill like that. But I'll tell you the disabled community that was in the area of D.C. that could be near the Congress, all right, they got out there and they were protesting pretty loudly, but they weren't getting the media attention that one might expect.
Reasonably
expect.
Yeah. And that, like, in itself is a profoundly difficult situation, because at one point, I mean, we feel like the topics like this for, like, you know, ADA, things like that should be covered more, because they're very important. And in another aspect, the, you know, the people would see the media as, well, you know, we're not required to cover, you know, everything that is what people would deem important. They're just there to record and to document events and times, you know, of what they prefer to. And the question is, you know, what is it? Like, is it a preference thing? Is it a disability thing? You know, we really don't know. But the thing is that, like, things like this, like the ADA changes, you know, accessibility, accommodations, reasonable expectations, this needs to be talked about because it gets swept under the rug so much because we don't have requirements. We have we don't even have regulations. We just have these guidelines that are just so, you know, there's so many problems. And then the new guidelines that they have for the ADA are just so out there that it's just like, you know, we're not getting any assistance and we're not able to speak about it. And then on top of it, we're not, you know, when we are able to speak about it, we're not being heard. So, I mean, you know, there's a lot of moving parts to this, particularly when it centers around media. That's a very interesting thing to ponder. But it's important. Like, whether you are an education person, a student, a business owner, a customer, whatever it is, this is very important to talk about. And what we want you guys to do is this. We want you guys to, you know, go to our Facebook, go to Twitter, go to Instagram, whatever it is. Put your comments in there or talk about it amongst other people, you know, that you heard this conversation. Because the more people that understand, you know, different ways of life and then also understanding, you know, that there is a lot to be talked about as to, you know, receiving accommodations as well as understanding what they are, you know, it's important. So, unfortunately though, we have run out of time for episode 29 though, but I'm sure we'll probably talk more on this in the future. So where can we find you, Tony, all them great social media networks?
Oh, I'm usually on LinkedIn. As a matter of fact, there's someone that I'm collaborating now. I'm curating an exhibit in May, soul exhibit by an artist by the name of Terry Strauss, outstanding artist that will be at Studio 4 in Peekskill, New York. We actually met on LinkedIn, and this will be the second exhibit that I've curated that she's actually in, but this one she's the solo artist because she's fantastic. I do write articles on LinkedIn, and I do hang out there. So if you want to, you know, reach out to me, please go there. I find that to be an excellent platform for artists that take themselves seriously as a business because you are a sole proprietor if you're an artist, like it or not. So you can reach out to me on LinkedIn if you're interested in some life coaching. I specialize in coaching for artists. And I do have a Twitter page, @TQTalker. I know, Peter, you're there most of the time, and you have a lot of followers there, and you probably prefer that. And I do have a Facebook page, but the best way to reach me is on LinkedIn.
Awesome. And, yeah, I appreciate the support of you. Thank you for coming on the show. Thank you guys for listening to the show. If you guys want to reach out to me, you can find me on Twitter at Peter Elvidge, PeterElvidge, all one word. You can also find me connected to the Perseverance Network, and please make sure to check out Perseverance Entertainment Network. It is a 24-hour streaming internet radio station with inspirational, motivational, educational content, including our podcast, Seen Beneath the Surface, amongst other great artists and contributors. But otherwise, thank you guys so very, very much. Thank you, Tony. Thank you, everyone, for your continuous support. We look forward to you guys being in episode 30 of Seeing Beneath the Surface, and we will see you guys in the next episode.